السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آج جماعت احمدیہ کے لیے
حضور says that today is an extremely happy day, a day filled with blessings for Jamaat Ahmadiyya, which has the added blessings of it being Jummah, or Friday. For it was approximately 123 years before today when that magnificent prophecy of the Holy Quran with relation to the second phase and revival of Islam was fulfilled. Similarly, a prophecy of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, was fulfilled in accordance with the details he had given regarding the promised Messiah and Imam Mahdi, whose advent thus took place. With the commencement of the Bayt, the Pledge of Allegiance, a Jamaat of the latter days who were joined with the earlier ones was established. We also are amongst those most fortunate ones who are benefiting from these blessings. Thus, each and every Ahmadi who claims to have taken the bear, the pledge of allegiance of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, should bear this point thoroughly in mind, that after coming into the pledge of allegiance of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, an immense responsibility is placed upon us. The task of the revival of Islam, which commenced with the promised Messiah alayhi salam, requires from the followers of the promised Messiah alayhi salam that they instill a revolutionary change within themselves, so that we can continue to partake in the blessings that are associated with the promised Messiah, on whom be peace. Thus, when every year the day of 23rd March arrives, we Ahmadi should not be merely joyous that today we are going to commemorate the promised Messiah Day or Masih Maud Day, or we should not be merely joyous that Alhamdulillah, all praise belongs to Allah, we are part of this Jamaat, or that we have come to learn of the early history of the Jamaat or the claim of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. This alone is not sufficient, or that merely we hold a jalsa in this regard. All of this is not enough. Rather, much more than this, we need to reflect that have we fulfilled the dues of this bayt and done justice to it? Today is also a day of self-analysis and accountability. It is a day to self-reflect on the requirements of the bid. It is a day to ponder over the conditions of the bid, that is the Pledge of Allegiance. It is also a day to renew our pledge. And it is also a day to generate steadfast resolve to adhere to the conditions of the Pledge of Allegiance. Whilst, on the one hand, this is a day to greatly glorify God for fulfilling the promises He made to the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. On the other hand, this is also a day to invoke thousands of blessings and salutations, durood and salam, upon the greatly beloved of Allah the Almighty, the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Thus, this significance of Masih Maud should always be kept in view. And this significance can be realized by reflecting on the conditions of the bid and implementing them practically. As a reminder towards this, today, once again, I will present the conditions of the bid, the Pledge of Allegiance. And I will also expound what the promised Messiah alayhi salam expected in light of these conditions. The first condition that one who joins Ahmadiyyat pledges to abide by is that the initiate shall solemnly promise that he or she shall abstain from shirk, that is, associating partners with God the Almighty, right up to the day of his or her death. The promised Messiah, on whom be peace, has said, Tawheed, or the unity of God, does not merely mean that you say, La ilaha illallah, there is none worthy of worship except Allah, verbally, but then hide hundreds of idols in your heart. In fact, any person who gives reverence to his own plans, mischief or designs, as he should revere God, or depends or relies upon another person, as he should depend or rely upon God alone, or he reveres his own ego as he should revere God alone, in all such conditions he is an idol worshipper in the sight of Allah the Exalted. Idols are not merely those that are made of gold, silver, copper or stones and then are depended upon. Rather, every single thing, every statement or every deed which is revered in a manner that befits Allah the Almighty alone, in the sight of Allah is an idol. Remember that true Tawheed, or the unity of God, which God requires us to affirm, and upon which salvation depends. It is exactly this, to believe that God, in His being, is free from every associate, whether it is an idol, or whether it is a human being, or the sun, or the moon, or one's ego, or one's cunning or deceit, and also to conceive of no one as possessing power in opposition to him, nor to accept anyone as sustainer, nor to hold anyone as bestowing honor or disgrace. Hazur says, one should not consider that anyone has the ability to honor or disgrace another. It's only God who can do so. And the promised Messiah continues, it is also to confine one's love to Him, to confine one's worship to Him, to confine one's humility with Him, and to confine one's hopes with Him, and to confine one's fear to Him. Thus, no Tawheed or belief in the unity of God can be complete without following these three types of aspects. Hazur says, what are those three types of particularizations? The promised Messiah says, first there is Tawheed, or unity of being, that is, to conceive the whole universe as non-existent in contrast with Him, and to consider it mortal and lacking reality. In other words, to believe that everything in the universe holds no value in comparison to Him. Everything will ultimately perish and come to an end, and therefore is valueless, and has no reality in comparison to God Almighty. The promised Messiah alayhi salam continues, secondly, the unity of attributes. that is, the Rububiyat and Uluhiyat, are confined to His being. Hazur says, in other words, that is, the Rabb is our Lord who sustains and nurtures us. It is He alone who has the power of Godhead and is the source and spring of all powers. And the promised Messiah alayhi salam continues, and all others who appear as sustainers or benefactors. Hazur says, all those others whom we benefit from, who appear to be sustainers. The promised Messiah continues, are only a part of the system set up by His hand. Hazur says, whomever we derive benefit from in the world, they are a part of the system of God. The promised Messiah says, thirdly, the unity of love, sincerity, and devotion. That is, to not consider anyone as an associate of God in the matter of love and worship, and to be entirely lost in Him. Hazur says, the second condition of the bear, the pledge of allegiance, is that he or she shall keep away from falsehood, fornication, adultery, trespasses of the eye, debauchery, dissipation, cruelty, and that he or she will not permit him or herself to be carried away by passions, however strong they may be. The promised Messiah, on whom be peace, states, the fact is that so long as a person does not renounce the selfish motives which prevent him from telling the truth, he cannot be considered truthful. For if a person tells the truth only when he stands to lose nothing, but tells a lie when his honor, property, or life are threatened, and refrains from telling the truth, how can he be considered better than children and the insane? There is hardly anyone in the world who would tell a lie without any motive. Therefore, the truth that is forsaken when faced with possible loss can never form part of true morals. The real occasion of telling the truth is when one apprehends loss of life or property or honor. In this context, the divine teaching is, فَاجْتَنِبُ الرِّجْسَ مِنَ الْأَوْسَانِ وَاجْتَنِبُ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَلَا يَعْبَ الشُّهَدَاءُ إِذَا مَا دُؤُوا وَلَا تَكْتُمُ الشَّهَادَةَ وَمَنْ يَكْتُمْهَا فَإِنَّهُ آثِمٌ قَلْبُهُ وَإِذَا قُلْتُمْ فَاعْدِلُوا وَلَوْ كَانَ ذَا قُرْبَى كُونُوا قَوَامِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ عَلَى أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَآنُ قَوْمٍ عَلَى أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ لَا يَشْهَدُونَ الزُّورَ. Explaining the meaning of this, the promised Messiah alayhi salam says, keep away from idol worship and lying, because falsehood too is an idol. One who relies upon it ceases to rely upon God. Hence, by telling lies, one loses God. When you are summoned to testify to the truth, do not refuse to do so. Do not conceal true testimony, and he who conceals it, his heart is certainly sinful. When you speak, speak only what is absolutely true and fair. Even when you testify against a close relative, hold fast to truth and justice, and bear witness only for the sake of Allah. Never utter a lie, even if telling the truth may endanger your lives or your parents' lives, or the lives of other loved ones like your children. Let not hostility towards a people prevent you from giving true testimony. Truthful men and truthful women will earn great reward. They are accustomed to counseling truth. They do not keep company with untruthful people. The promised Messiah, on whom be peace, says further regarding this, And in this second condition, many aspects are entailed. And he says, do not go near adultery. That is to say, avoid all occasions that create even the thought in your mind. Avoid all ways that carry a risk of getting involved in this sin. Whoever commits adultery goes to the limit of evil. Hazur says, certain programs on certain TV channels nowadays that are even found on the internet are such that they lead one towards this vice. Then there is adultery of the eyes. You should save yourself from it. In fact, one should save himself from every single of those aspects that leads him towards this vice. The promised Messiah, on whom be peace, says, adultery is an extremely evil way. It stops you from reaching your true objective and carries major risks in it. Hazrat says, what should be your ultimate objective? It should be obtaining Allah the Almighty's pleasure. This is that final stage and target, and this vice hinders one from achieving that objective. Then, amongst the other aspects of the second condition, one is illicit glances. The promised Messiah, on whom be peace, says, the Holy Quran, which lays down appropriate directions with reference to the natural desires and weaknesses of man, has adopted an excellent course in this regard. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغَزُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ وَيَحْفَزُوا فَرُوجَهُمْ ذَلِكَ أَزْقَى لَهُمْ. That direct the believing men to restrain their looks and to guard their furuj. That is the act through which they will attain purification. Here, the word furuj does not only mean the private parts, rather it refers to all parts of entry in the body, including even the ears. It has been prohibited to hear the song of an unrelated woman. Remember, it is proven by hundreds of experiments that if God prohibits something, man has to leave it sooner or later. The promised Messiah, on whom be peace, further explains, Islam has enjoined men and women equally on the observation of these conditions. As women are prescribed to wear the veil, so too are men commanded regarding ghadh-e basar to keep the eyes glanced down. Obligatory prayer, fasting, zakat, hajj, the distinction between halal and haram, avoiding un-Islamic custom to honor God's commandment are all injunctions that make the door of Islam extremely narrow, and that is why everyone cannot enter this door. With relation to how to save oneself from immorality and vices, the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, states, when wickedness and immorality exceeded the limits, and people started disrespecting the commandments and signs of Allah the Almighty, Hazrat says, that is Muslims and people of other religions, and were lost into the affairs of the world, and its adornment God caused their ruin. Hazrat says, he is speaking with reference to the Muslims, and he says, caused their ruin at the hands of Halaku and Genghis Khan. It is written that at that time a cry was heard from heaven, Ayyuhal kuffaru uqtulul fujjar, that, O disbelievers, kill the wicked and immoral. In short, the wicked and immoral are lower and more despicable than disbelievers in the eyes of Allah the Exalted. Regarding saving oneself from disorder and discord, the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, states, do not engage in fighting or discord with those who leave you because you have joined a movement established by Allah the Exalted. Instead, pray for them in secret that Allah the Supreme may grant them the insight and cognition that He has granted you through His grace. With your pious example and good behavior, prove that you have adopted the right path. Listen, I am appointed to admonish you repeatedly to avoid all occasions of discord and disturbance. Have patience even if you hear abuse. Respond to evil with goodness. If you encounter discord, it is better that you slip away from the situation or respond with kind words. When I learn that someone has quarreled despite being a member of my Jamaat, I am extremely displeased. Allah the Exalted also does not like that the Jamaat that is destined to become a model for mankind should adopt such ways, which are not the ways of taqwa or righteousness and the fear of God. Indeed, I should state further that Allah the Almighty has emphasized this matter so much so that if someone declaring his membership of the Jamaat does not display patience and perseverance, should remember he does not belong to this Jamaat. The utmost cause of your provocation might be that you hear people abusing me. The promised Messiah alayhi salam says people may use profane and foul language and abuse me. But he says, leave that matter for God to decide. You cannot judge it. Leave my affair to God. You should show patience even in the face of such abuse. Hazur says, this is exactly what is instructed to the Ahmadis in Pakistan today. They have exceeded all limits of the use of abuse and profane language against the promised Messiah, on whom be peace. There is only and only one solution to this, that we go on praying most profusely. Then the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, explaining how one can save themselves from selfish passions, says, accept that which is testified by intellect and human conscience, and is testified by the books of God. The promised Messiah, on whom be peace, says, do not commit adultery, do not tell lies, avoid illicit glances. Safeguard yourselves from wickedness, immorality, cruelty, dishonesty, and ways of rebellion. Do not be overpowered by carnal desires. Offer the 5 daily prayers, because the human nature undergoes 5 types of revolutions. Be grateful to your noble messenger, and invoke durood or blessings upon him, for he is the one who showed you the way of recognizing God in the age of darkness. Hazur says, the third condition of the Bayt, the Pledge of Allegiance, is that he or she shall regularly offer the 5 daily prayers in accordance with the commands of God and the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, and shall try his or her best to be regular in offering the tahajjud and invoking durood, salutations and peace on the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he or she shall make it his or her daily routine to ask forgiveness for his or her sins and to remember the bounties and favors of God and to remember the bounties of God and to praise and glorify him. The promised Messiah alayhi salam, peace be upon him, states, all ye people who count yourself as members of my Jamaat, in heaven you shall be counted among members of my following only when you truly begin to advance on the path of taqwa. Offer your 5 daily obligatory prayers with such concentration and awe of mine as though you were seeing God right in front of you. Observe the days of fasting for the sake of God in full sincerity. All those who are liable to pay zakat should do so, and all those upon whom hajj is obligatory and have no obstacle standing in the way should do so. Do all good deeds with the proper care they deserve, forsaking evil. Be very sure that no action whatsoever can reach God if it is devoid of taqwa. The root of everything good is taqwa. In whatever action this root is not lost, that action will never be devoid or futile. Then the promised Messiah alayhi salam states that the prayer is so powerful that the heavens incline towards the humans with it. Hazur says, in other words, when one does full justice to prayers, God comes near to him. The promised Messiah says that one who does full justice to prayers feels that he has died, his soul has melted and fallen at the threshold of Allah. A house in which prayer is offered in this manner will never face destruction. It is said in Hadith that if prayer had been ordained to the people of Noah, they would never have been ruined. Hajj is obligatory, but with certain prerequisites. So is fasting and zakat. But the obligation to offer prayer has no prerequisites. All other obligations are discharged once a year, but the prayer is ordained 5 times a day. Thus, as long as the prayer is not performed in accordance with all its requirements, it does not earn the blessings that it carries. Such allegiance without discharging these obligations is not of any benefit. The promised Messiah says regarding tahajjud, get up at night and supplicate that Allah the Almighty may guide you to his path. The companions of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, also received their training step by step. What were they before? They were like a seed sown by a farmer. Then the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in turn watered and prayed for it. The seed was healthy and the soil was fertile. With watering it yielded excellent fruit. They walked the path of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. They did not wait for day or night. You should repent with a true heart. Wake up for tahajjud. Straighten your hearts. Leave your weaknesses and make your words and deeds correspond to the will of Allah, the Almighty. Then the promised Messiah, Anub, peace, says about Durood, man essentially is a servant or a slave. The task of a slave is that he carries out all the commands of his master and does whatever he says. Similarly, if you want to achieve grace through the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, it is necessary that you become his slave. Allah the Almighty says in the Holy Quran, قُلْ يَا إِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Here, slave means an obedient servant and not creation. To become a slave of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, it is essential to invoke Allah's blessings upon him, not to disobey any of his commandments, and to carry out all his injunctions. Then regarding istighfar or repentance, the promised Messiah ﷺ says, when one seeks strength from Allah, that is, does his istighfar, one's weaknesses can be removed with the help of the Holy Spirit, and one can be safeguarded from the sin, like the prophets and the messengers are saved. And if there be someone who has already become a sinner, istighfar saves him from the consequences of his evil deeds. That is, from punishment. Fazul says, if somebody mistakenly carries out a sin, istighfar saves him from the evil results of that sin he has performed. The promised Messiah continues, for no darkness can stay in the face of light. However, the wrongdoers who do not do istighfar suffer the consequences of their misdeeds and they incur punishment. Hazrat says, the fourth condition of the bayt, the pledge of allegiance, is that under the impulse of any passions, he or she shall cause no harm whatsoever to the creatures of God in general and to Muslims in particular, neither by his or her tongue, hands, nor any other means. The promised Messiah, on whom be peace, states, of these, the first moral quality is forgiveness. That is, to forgive someone's sins. The virtue in this is that the person who commits a sin causes harm to someone else and therefore becomes liable to be punished or to be put in jail or to be fined or to be chastised with direct action. Thus, to forgive him, if forgiveness is appropriate, would be a good deed in his favor. The teaching of the Holy Quran in this regard is وَالْقَازِمِينَ الْغَيْزَ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ غَزَىٰ أُسَيِّئَةٍ مِثْلُهَا فَمَا نَفَىٰ وَأَسْلَحَ فَأَجْرَهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. That is, the virtuous are those who suppress their anger when it is appropriate and forgive when it is appropriate to forgive sins. A bad deed should be requited with an equal amount, but in situation where a person forgives, and where forgiveness of sin is corrective and can cause reformation without causing any harm. That is, forgiveness is granted when the occasion warrants, and not otherwise. Then it merits reward. Then the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, states, a person should not be impudent, he should not be shameless, he should not treat other people bad, he should treat people lovingly and kindly. Due to his selfish interests, he should not hold rancor or grudges against anyone else, and he should be gentle or firm, appropriate according to the occasion. Regarding humbleness, the promised Messiah alayhi salam states, seek forgiveness of Allah before the punishment of God comes to close the door of forgiveness. While the laws of this world are feared, why is it the laws of God are not? When calamities have occurred, one has to go through them. Everyone should try to get up for tahajjud and to include kunut in the five daily prayers as well. Repent from everything that would incur the wrath of Allah. Repentance means giving up all deeds and everything that goes against the pleasure of God the Exalted, and to undergo a true change, and to make progress and advancement, and to adopt the ways of taqwa. In this too lies the mercy of Allah. Make your habits decent. Hazur says the various manners and habits of a person should be made into good habits and good manners. The promised Messiah, on whom be peace, says, shun anger, replacing it with gentleness and meekness. Hazrat says, replace anger with humbleness. Then the promised Messiah continues, along with adopting good morals, you should give charity as well. يُطِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا, which means that for seeking the pleasure of God, you feed the poor, the orphans, and the needy, and you say that you perform these acts only for the pleasure of Allah the Almighty, and that you fear the extremely terrible day. In brief, pray, ask forgiveness, and keep giving charity, so that Allah the Exalted may deal with you with His grace and mercy. Hazrat says the fifth condition of the bear, the pledge of allegiance, is that he or she shall remain faithful to God in all circumstances of life, in sorrow and in happiness, in adversity and in prosperity, in felicity and in trial, and that he or she shall in all conditions remain resigned to the decree of God, and to keep him or herself ready to face all kinds of indignities and sufferings in his way, and shall never turn away from him at the onslaught of any misfortune. On the contrary, he or she shall march forward. The promised Messiah on whom be peace states, the people of the highest grade among the people, that is, people who are completely lost in the pleasure of Allah and sell themselves to earn the pleasure of God. Hazrat says, in other words, this is those who do not care about their own selves. They only give up everything for the sake of God. The promised Messiah continues, these are the people upon whom the mercy of Allah descends. In this verse, the Allah the Almighty says, Hazrat says here, he has not given the Arabic verse, but he has given the interpretation. So the promised Messiah says, only he is delivered from all tribulations who sells his self in my way and for my pleasure. He proves with his utmost endeavors that he belongs to God and considers his entire being as something that has been fashioned for obedience of the Creator and service to creation. Then the promised Messiah alayhi salam says regarding how to attain the love of God, he says, a loved one of God sells his being in the way of God. In return, he earns the pleasure of God. Such are the ones upon whom the special mercy of God descends. Then the promised Messiah alayhi salam says regarding the connection of faithfulness to God, every true believer passes through such circumstances. If he becomes his with sincerity and fidelity, Allah becomes his friend. But if the structure of faith is weak, there are dangers. We have no knowledge of the secrets of anybody's heart, but anyone who totally belongs to Allah receives his special protection. Although he is the God of everyone, he manifests especially to those who hand themselves over to God completely. To hand oneself over to God entails that the self be totally eradicated and nothing should remain of it. That is why I tell my Jamaat again and again that they should take no pride in merely taking the pledge. If the heart is not purified, there is no merit in placing the hands in my hand. Hazrat says, in other words, just putting your hand in another hand will have no value. So he continues, but anyone who makes a true pledge attains forgiveness of even major sins and receives a new life. Hazrat says, the sixth condition of the bear, the pledge of allegiance, is that he or she shall refrain from following un-Islamic customs and lustful inclinations, and shall completely submit him or herself to the authority of the Holy Quran, and that he or she shall make the word of God and the sayings of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam his or her guiding principles in every walk of his or her life. Hazrat says, before presenting a quote to the promised Messiah on whom be peace, I shall relate a hadith. Hadith Amr bin Auf has narrated that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has stated, the person who revives any one of my sunnah or practices so that others start following it. He will reap the reward equal to all those persons' rewards who act upon that sunnah, and their reward shall remain with them. The person who introduces an innovation and others adopt that, he shall share in the sins of all those who act upon that innovation, and their sins will remain with them as well. The promised Messiah, on whom be peace, has expounded, look, Allah the Exalted says in the Holy Quran, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. The only way to please Allah the Almighty is to be fully obedient to the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. And there is no other way that will lead you to the communion with God. The final objective of man should always be to find the one God who has no associate. He should shun associating partners with God and indulging in innovations. He should obey the messenger and not follow his personal lusts and base desires. Listen, I say again, man cannot succeed in any other way but by treading the true path of the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam of Allah. We have only one messenger and only one Holy Quran, which was revealed to that messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, obeying whom we can find God. The innovations introduced by the present day fuqara, hermits, and the methods of the durud and wazahif, that is the prayer incantations, invented by the leaders of the hermitages, are all a tool that lead a man astray. Stay away from them, therefore. These people have tried to break the Khatamul Anbiya, the seal of the prophethood of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in a way they have made a separate Sharia. You should remember that apart from adhering to the injunctions of the Holy Quran and to follow the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to establish prayer and to keep fast in the established manner, there is no other key for opening the door of God the Almighty's blessings and grace. That person is lost who adopts any new path instead of following those established ways. That person shall end up dying in failure, who does not comply with the dictates of Allah and His Messenger and searches instead for divergent paths. Hazur says the seventh condition of the Bayt, the Pledge of Allegiance, is that he or she shall entirely give up pride and vanity and shall pass all his or her life in humbleness, cheerfulness, forbearance and meekness. Regarding arrogance, the promised Messiah on whom be peace states, I tell you truly that on the day of judgment after shirk, associating partners with Allah, there will be no evil like arrogance. This is an evil that disgraces man in both worlds. Divine mercy redresses everyone who believes in the unity of God, but not the arrogant. Hazur says, the mercy of Allah the Almighty descends upon all those who believe in God, who believe Him to be one, and Allah helps all such people. The sins of all such people are forgiven by God. However, Allah does not forgive an arrogant person. The promised Messiah continues, Satan too claimed to believe in one God. However, he was arrogant and contemptuous towards Adam, whom God loved. Satan criticized him and therefore was ruined, and the yoke of curse hung around his neck. Thus, the first sin for which a person was eternally ruined was indeed arrogance. The promised Messiah further says, if you have any element of arrogance or hypocrisy or conceit or indolence, then you are not worthy of acceptance. Let it not happen that over only a few things you deceive yourself that whatever you could have achieved, you have, that it is sufficient to just have taken the pledge. Rather, God desires that your entire being should undergo a complete revolution. He demands a death from you, after which He shall give you life. Then, regarding destitute people, the promised Messiah on whom be peace states, if you wish to find Allah the Almighty, seek Him near the hearts of the meek. This is the reason prophets of God adopted meekness. Similarly, it is required that people of bigger nations do not deride smaller nations, nor should anyone say that his ancestry is higher. Allah the Almighty states that when you come before me, I shall not inquire of you about your nation. Rather, the question would be, what are your deeds? Likewise, the Prophet ﷺ of God said to his daughter that, O Fatima, Allah the Almighty shall not inquire into one's lineage. If you commit a wrong, Allah the Almighty shall not condone you because you are the daughter of the Messenger. Thus, you should watch what you do at all times. Hazur says, the eighth condition of the Bayt, the Pledge of Allegiance, is that he or she shall hold faith, the honor of faith, and the cause of Islam dearer than his or her life, wealth, honor, children, and all loved ones. The promised Messiah on whom be peace states, the revival of Islam demands a ransom from us. What is it? It is us dying in this very path. This is the death upon which the life of Islam, the life of Muslims, and the manifestation of the living God depend. This is exactly what is called Islam. And God now wants to revive this very Islam. To bring about this great undertaking, it is essential that a grand enterprise that would be effective in every aspect should be established by his own initiative. So, the wise and powerful God did exactly that by sending this humble one for the reformation of mankind. Hazur says, thus the purpose of the advent of the promised Messiah alayhi salam was to bring about reformation. And we who follow him must ponder on this. The ninth condition of the bear, the Pledge of Allegiance, is that he or she shall keep himself or herself occupied in the service of God's creatures for his sake only, and shall endeavor towards the beneficence of mankind to the best of his or her God-given abilities and powers. The promised Messiah alayhi salam states, remember that God Almighty likes good deeds very much, and he desires that sympathy be shown for his creation. If he desired harm, he would have directed us to be bad, but the majesty of God is free from this. Holy is Allah and great is his station. Therefore, all of you who have established a relationship with me should remember that you should show compassion for everyone regardless of their religion and be good to all without any discrimination, because this is the teaching of the Holy Quran. وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا وَأَسِيرًا. Those captives and prisoners at the time of the Prophet were mostly non-believers. Now you can see the scope of kindness in Islam. In my opinion, perfect and moral teaching is not found anywhere except in Islam. Then the promised Messiah alayhi salam says, I am deeply grieved when I see or hear that someone did something that does not conform to Islamic teachings. I am not happy by such accounts. He says, I view the Jamaat as a child, which takes two steps forward and falls four times. However, I have certainty that Allah the Almighty will perfect this Jamaat. Therefore, you should also make efforts, plans, and strive and continuously pray that Allah may show His grace, because nothing is possible without His grace. When He bestows His favor, all avenues open. Then the promised Messiah on whom be peace states, be kind and merciful to humanity. Do not oppress them with your tongue, your hands, or in any other way. Always work for the good of mankind. Never unduly assert yourself with pride over others, even those who are placed under you. Never use abusive language for anyone, even if he may abuse you. Be humble in spirit, kind, gentle and forgiving, sympathetic towards all, and wish them well so that you may be accepted. If you are highly placed, have mercy on those who are lowly, and do not have contempt. If you are wise and well versed in learning, serve the ignorant with words of wisdom. Never desire to bring disgrace on the lack of knowledge by trying to show off your learning. If you are rich, instead of treating the poor with self-centered, disdainful pride, you should serve them. Hazur says, the tenth condition of the bayt is that he or she shall enter into a bond of brotherhood with this humble servant of God, pledging obedience to me in everything good for the sake of God, and remain faithful to it until the day of his or her death. That he or she shall exert such a high devotion in the observance of this bond as is not to be found in any other worldly relationship and connection that demands devoted dutifulness. The promised Messiah on whom be peace states, this Prophet directs you in the matters that are not opposed to logic. This is in regards to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he says, and he prohibits you from things that common sense also prohibits you from, and he makes pure things lawful and impure things unlawful, and he removes the burdens from the nations that they were buried under, and he frees them from the shackles that were preventing their necks from being straightened. Therefore, those people who will believe in him and will strengthen him by joining him and will help him and will follow the light that has been brought down with him, they will escape the hardships of this world and the hereafter. As Guru says, in other words, these are the commands of the Sharia, and these are good commands for a person to obtain salvation from removing the burdens of this world. Then the promised Messiah states, Now rush towards me, because this is the time that he who runs towards me is like the one who gets on board the ship right at the time of a fierce storm. But if someone does not accept me, I see that He is throwing himself into a storm and has no means of saving himself. I am a true intercessor as a shadow and reflection of that exalted intercessor, in other words, the Holy Prophet who was not accepted by the ignorant people of that age and who was gravely insulted, that is, Hadrat Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Then the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, states, and here he is counseling us at the end. O dear ones, O beloved ones, O the flourishing branches of the tree of my being, who by the mercy of God Almighty, which you enjoy because of having entered into the covenant of birth, pledge of allegiance with me, you are devoting your lives, comfort, and properties to this cause. Then the promised Messiah alayhi salam says, who is my friend and who is dear to me? Only he who recognizes me. Who recognizes me? Only he who believes that I have been sent and accepts me, as those are accepted who are sent. The world cannot accept me because I am not of the world. But those whose natures have been invested with a portion of the other world accept me and will accept me. He who turns away from me turns aside from him who has sent me. And he who establishes a relationship with me establishes a relationship with him from whom I have come. I hold a lamp in my hand. He who comes to me will surely partake of its light, but he who, out of ill-thinking, runs away will be cast into the darkness. I am the citadel of security for this age, that is, the fort who provides protection. He who enters therein will be secure against thieves and robbers and wild beasts. However, he who seeks to remain away from my walls will be confronted with death from every direction, and even his dead body will not be saved. Who is it who enters my fort? Only he who discards vice and adopts goodness, and gives up crookedness and treads along the path of truth, and frees himself from the bondage of Satan, and becomes an obedient servant of Allah the Almighty. Everyone who does that is in me and I am in him, but only he has the power to attain this, upon whom Allah the Almighty bestows a pure soul. Then he places his foot in the hell of such a one's inner self, and it becomes cool as if there has never been any fire in it. Hazur says, when a person purifies himself, beforehand he places his foot in the fire of his inner self, but then purifies himself. Then the fire of his inner self is completely extinguished, as if it has never existed. Then the promised Messiah says, he marches forward until the spirit of Allah the Almighty dwells in him. And with a special manifestation, the Rabbul Alameen, the Lord of the world, establishes himself in his heart. That is, Allah the Almighty establishes his throne in his heart. Then his old humanity is consumed and a new and pure humanity is bestowed on him. For him, Allah the Almighty becomes a new Lord and establishes a new special relationship with him, and he is equipped in this very life with the pure fittings of a heavenly life. Hazur says, these are those teachings and desires which the promised Messiah, on whom be peace, expected us to act upon and to follow. This is a standard he has set for the initiate of the Bayt, the Pledge of Allegiance. Therefore, today, we need to self-reflect and self-analyze our own selves, that are we truly striving to lead our lives in accordance with these conditions of the Bayt? May Allah the Almighty forgive our weaknesses and our shortcomings and enable us to overcome them. And may He grant us the ability to inculcate pious reformations if we have virtues within us. May Allah the Almighty enable them to increase further. May Allah the Almighty enable us to achieve this, so that we can come to achieve the objective of the Bayt, the Pledge of Allegiance of the promised Messiah, on whom be peace. Today I had kept some notes just in case with reference to Pakistan, because on 23rd March, Yom-e-Pakistan or Pakistan Day is being commemorated. I will say in this regard to Pakistani Ahmadis to pray. For nowadays, the juncture which the country is passing through is extremely perilous. May Allah the Almighty save this country for the sake of Ahmadis, because Ahmadis have profusely prayed for this country to be saved. Yet still allegations are put upon Ahmadis. For this reason, I have extracted certain facts which I will present here, which show to what extent Ahmadis have continued to play a role in the creation of Pakistan. Dor-e-Jadid, or New Age, was a newspaper. In 1923, they wrote regarding Chaudhry Zafrullah Khan Sahib that all the Muslims of the Punjab Council, who certainly had the legitimate right of being called Muslim representatives of the Punjab Council, felt the need that from Punjab a reliable and authoritative representative should go to England on behalf of Punjab. Then the esteemed and laudable personality of Chaudhry Zafrullah Khan Sahib was whom their eyes cast upon to be elected for this job. Chaudhry Sahib spent his own money for this purpose, and he so excellently and in such a splendid manner did he present the issues in England to the politicians, etc., that not only was this acknowledged by the Punjab Council, but also by the government itself. These are those facts, these are those illuminating realities, which at least the newspaper community around the world cannot deny or reject at any time. Then, amongst the prominent literary personalities, Mulana Muhammad Ali Johar Sahib, in his newspaper Hamdard on 26 September 1927, writes, "It would be ungrateful if Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmed and his organized Jamaat or community are not mentioned here, who, despite differences of beliefs and viewpoints, expend all their energy for the welfare of the Muslims. A time is not far off when this organized and disciplined community's example will be a guiding way for the Muslims in general, and in particular for those people who sit inside the mosques or in their specific areas or domes, where they make lofty and insignificant claims and are addicted to doing so." Hazur says, in other words, Mulana Muhammad Ali Johar Sahib is not only appreciating and acknowledging the efforts and endeavors of Jamaat Ahmadiyya, rather here he considers Jamaat Ahmadiyya as a sect among the Muslims, whereas nowadays attempts are made to remove Jamaat Ahmadiyya's name from the history of Pakistan. They do not acknowledge a Jamaat historically, and also on a constitutional level do not accept the Jamaat. Similarly, a great journalist, Khwaja Hassan Nizami, wrote in relation to the Round Table Conference that every Hindu and every Muslim and every Englishman who accepted the ability of Chaudhry Zafrullah Khan Sahib, the English accepted the capabilities of Chaudhry Zafrullah Khan Sahib and stated, if there is any amongst the Muslims who does not state useless and pointless things and who understands the politics of the new age and the situation in the current times, then it is only Chaudhry Zafrullah Khan Sahib. Hazur says, this is from the newspaper Munadi, 24th October 1934, with reference to the history of Pakistan, Jamaat Ahmadiyya. Dr. Ashik Hussain Badalvi Sahib writes that from amongst the participants of the roundtable conference, the most successful Muslims were Aga Khan and Chaudhry Zafrullah Khan Sahib. This is from the book Iqbal's Akhri Do Saal, Iqbal's Final 2 Years, and this has been published by the Iqbal Academy Pakistan. Then Hadrat Qadi Azam, the founder of Pakistan, regarding returning to politics and returning to India, said, "Now I feel as if I can no longer help India in any way." That is when he left India and had come to England. And he said, "I can cause no change in the Hindu mentality, nor can I open the eyes of the Muslims. Finally, I decided to settle in London permanently." Hazur says, Rais Jafri Sahib has mentioned this in his book. At that time, Jamaat Ahmadiyya made efforts to make him return to India. Hazrat Khalifa Masih Sani, the second Khalifa, sent Hadrat Abdurrahim Dard Sahib, the Imam of the Fazl Mosque, to go to Qadi Azam and put pressure on him to return and to guide the Muslims so that their rights can be fulfilled. Finally, Qadi Azam, as a result, returned to India and declared that he would spend his efforts in service to the Muslims. And he said spontaneously, "The eloquent persuasion of the Imam left me no escape." In other words, the eloquent and persuasive dialogue of the Imam of the Fazl Mosque, his excellent advice and counsel left me no way of escape, is what he meant. A well-known journalist, Muhammad Shafiq, who is well-known by the name of Mim Sheen, said it is Mr. Liaquat Ali Khan and Mulana Abdurrahim Dard who persuaded Muhammad Ali Jinnah to change his mind and to return to his country and play his role in national politics. As a result of this, Muhammad Ali Jinnah in 1934 returned to India and was elected to the Central Assembly unopposed. This is from Pakistan time, 11 September 1981. Even the fiercest opponents also made an admittance. Subsequently, the Majlis-e-Ihrar published a book with the title of Muslim League and the Hide and Seek with the Mirzayo, a short analysis, written in 1946, in which it was clearly written that Mr. Jinnah delivered a speech in Quetta and he appreciated the policy of Mirza Mahmud in terms of his support for the Muslim League. Subsequently, all Mirzayon gave votes for the Muslim League. Famous Ahle Hadith scholar Mir Ibrahim Sialkoti Sahib, in his book Pegame Hidayat o Taid Pakistan o Muslim League, writes that the Ahmadis coming under the banner of the flag of Islam proves that the Muslim League is actually and in reality is that one representative community of the Muslims. In other words, in his view, Ahmadis are Muslims and they played a prominent role in the creation of Pakistan. Then Jodi Zafrullah Khan's services before the Boundary Commission. Hamid Nizami Sahib, the founder of the newspaper Nawai Waqt, has written in prominent and good words. Whereas today, Hazur says, the Nawai Waqt writes in great opposition to Jamaat Ahmadiyya. Their policy has changed because they now consider worldly benefits more. In any case, Hamid Nizami Sahib, who was the founder of the Nawai Waqt, says, "The meeting of the Boundary Commission ended. For 4 days, Sir Muhammad Zafrullah Khan Sahib presented a case solidly, scholarly, with accomplishment and full of arguments. Success lies in the hands of God Almighty. However, the great ability and excellent manner in which Sir Zafrullah Khan Sahib presented the case of the Muslims must at the very least have been satisfied that the facts and realities in a most eloquent and beautiful manner was presented to the government. Sir Zafrullah Khan Sahib had very little time to prepare the case, but through his ability, he fulfilled his responsibility in a spectacular manner. We believe that all the Muslims of Punjab, irrespective of their beliefs, they will acknowledge and be grateful for this service of his." Then, in terms of the disturbances in 1973, when the Jamaat's case was presented in the Inquiry Commission, Justice Munir was a judge at the time. He writes that baseless allegations have been raised against Jamaat Ahmadiyya, that the reason why the district of Gurdaspur has been included in India, that Ahmadis adopted a peculiar approach, and Chaudhry Zafrullah Khan Sahib, who Qadi Azam elected to present the case of the Muslim League before this commission, also presented specific or peculiar arguments. But the president of this commission, in other words, he is speaking about himself, who was also a member of the Boundary Commission. He was a member alongside Jodhri Zafrullah Khan Sahib, says, "I feel it is my duty to extend my gratitude and gratefulness to Jodhri Zafrullah Khan Sahib in terms of his services towards the district of Gurdaspur. This is undeniably and absolutely clear from the records of the Boundary Commission. Whoever has interest in this can most certainly study this record. Jodi Zafrullah Khan Sahib provided services for the Muslims with great selflessness. Despite this fact, some people and some communities, the manner in which they have spoken about him in terms of his involvement in the community is greatly ungrateful. Hazuru says, this ungratefulness is rapidly on the rise in most political parties in Pakistan. Then the circumstances of Pakistan at present are clear for all to see. Therefore, with reference to this day, pray profusely for your country, Pakistan. May God the Almighty save Pakistan from the destruction that it is heading towards.
Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد ان لا اله الا الله ونشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل واللسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر